I haven't been up here for about a year, so I'm older, and the jury's still out as to whether I'm wiser. So, did you know that in the book of Genesis, people lived at the beginning of Genesis, that they lived for longer. They lived for a few hundred years, quite a few hundred years. I think it was Methuselah who actually lived for 969 years. But then God changed it, mixed it up a bit, and he said our years were going to be 70 years and 10. A score is 20, so that's 70. Now, if you think of a week, think of Monday as 10 years, Tuesday as 10 years, Wednesday as 10 years, Thursday as 10 years, etc. Then by my reckoning, I'm just about to sit down to Sunday lunch. How's your week going? How's your weekend going, rather? But God gives bank holiday Mondays. And he gives bank holiday Tuesdays, but very rarely does he give a bank holiday Wednesday. But even if he does do that, and we live to 100, just over, that doesn't even score, register a blip on eternity. But what we do here with the time that we have is vitally important to how our future is shaped. What we do is vitally important, how we relate to each other, how we relate to God, that's most important. It's what shapes our future. Are you aware of your surroundings? You'd probably say you were, wouldn't you? Look out the window, see houses, trees, sky, people in here, friends in here, family, friends at home. But are you aware that we're all just hanging in space? I mean, you know it, but you're aware of it right now. Are you aware that we're on planet Earth and we're just hanging and just doing a little bit of movement? And there's an intricate, wonderfully choreographed dance that's going on between the sun, the moon, and the earth. And that's what we're doing now, but we're not aware of it, are we? We're not aware of that, all that spinning and orbiting that's going on. We know when it's light, we're facing the sun. We know when it's dark, we've turned around and we're not facing the sun. But we're in that intricate dance that's going on always. But we're not aware. More awesome than that which we're a part of, but have don't always realise what's going on. More important than that, more awesome than that, is this fact. Now, it can take a while, it can take years for this fact to drop from your head to your heart. So if it hasn't dropped, hold on to your chair, because this might be the day when it drops for you. Maybe it won't, but maybe it will. This amazing fact has already been spoken of today very well. The same Holy Spirit, the very, very same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead 2,000 years ago, the very same one, is living in you. Is living in you. The very, very same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is living in you. Take a moment. I was a Christian for more than 20 years before that turned into heart knowledge. And when it hit and it changed my whole perspective. I had God living in me. I understood it much better. And the day that that hit, I remember waving Neil off to work, waving Nathan off to school, and I hopped back into bed to read my Bible. I was in Romans, and that's the verse I read. And it hit me like a ton of bricks, the enormity of that verse. I'd read it before, I knew it was there, but that particular day, it hit me, and the penny dropped from my head to my heart. And I was scared stiff. So what I did, I hid under the bedclothes. I thought, God, you can't even look at me. I'm a sinful woman. what are you doing? No, how can you live in me? Because I say, I knew the verse, I knew the words, but it hadn't gone from my head to my heart. And I just hid. I just had to go and hide under the bedclothes and sort of try and come to grips with it. And that verse just changed my whole perspective. And I'm so glad that Jesus revealed that to me in that way. Because I don't think I could have lived my life and the challenges that have come along life's way and just paid lip service to that verse. Yes, the Holy Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead lives in me. No, the Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me, lives in you. Hallelujah. Wow. That is something to get really excited about and to actually live in the boldness of our God with him, walking with him, and just knowing. So the title of my talk today was Be Mindful of My Presence. And when we're mindful of his presence, the fact that he does live in us, he is that close to us, it changes how we look at things because we see things through his eyes. I don't think I could have done it I couldn't have done it without him. The closeness, the fact that I can just turn to God, and because he's there. There's been so many times when I've just been, it's just getting into step with him. That's what it seems like, just getting into step and think, once you start, you know, you start getting anxious, you start getting angry, but once you start getting into step with the Lord, once you are aware of his presence, paying attention to his presence, living in the knowledge of his presence, then you change. How you view things changes. I think I've told you a few times that when I first started using the white cane, I used it as a weapon of mass destruction. It was like, get out of my way. I behave a lot better. I think I behave a lot better, but I still managed to trip someone up the other day when I was out, but there you go, that wasn't on purpose. Get in step with God. Be aware of his presence. Pay attention to his presence. Live in the knowledge of his presence. It makes a difference. I was going to give you a little demonstration with a balloon, how it is, but when we're aware of God's presence and it changes something like that. But it worked many years ago. When we tried it last night, it didn't. The construction of a sellotape and the balloon has obviously changed over the years. When you blow a balloon up, so it's really like to its fullest, and you put a bit of sellotape over it, used to, not unless it's the wrong sellotape we're using, we used two different sorts, it still didn't work. You put the sellotape over a blown-up balloon, you put a pin in it, and it goes down immediately, but with no noise whatsoever. And it's a quick deflate. Just 1 second it's there, half a second later, not there, and no noise. And that's what I wanted to demonstrate to you today, but it didn't work, so I'll try and say it. What I'm saying this for is that when you're aware of God in the situation, we can get so puffed up, blown up with anger. We can get blown up with anxiety. And with anxiety, when it gets too much, we just want to scream. And can I tell you that if you scream in a pillow, no one hears. That's free. I just got that. Sorry. But, yeah, there have been times when I've just wanted to absolutely yell with frustration, with fear. I've been pacing around, and then I had that thought, talk to God. And I wish I'd talked to God before, because I wouldn't have got into that state. And I just dived into the bedroom, sat down, and all I had to do, I just lifted my head. I didn't even say anything. I just lifted my head to look at God. And it was like that balloon being pierced, all the air coming out, but no noise. So all the pent-up feeling just went. It wasn't a slow going away. It's like sat down, looked at God, just took the breath to say something, gone, and in its place, peace. That was quite shocking in one sense, but really grateful in another for God doing that, because it's his presence. As we were singing and as we're hearing today, it's his presence. It changes everything. We need to be aware of his presence, and then he will step in, because we're given him permission to step in. We're looking at him. He doesn't barge into us, as Shelley said earlier, he's a gentleman. He doesn't barge anywhere. We welcome him in. We look at him. We focus on him. And with anger, some of you have heard this, some of you maybe not, but many, many years ago, so I don't do it now. We don't do it so badly now. Neil was in the living room, just come home from work, working on the computer straight away, on church stuff. I was in the kitchen cooking food. And whatever the strife was between us, I have no idea, probably nothing serious. But he was yelling at me from the living room to the kitchen. I was yelling back, and it went on, and I'm getting more cross. And I really did. I took the breath. I sort of marched to the end of the kitchen to go through the door and then to sort of splurge all my anger out on him. That was my plan, and that's what I was doing. I got to the kitchen door, took the breath, because the living room door's right next to it. Took the breath, absolutely enraged. Just had it in my mind's eye, I saw Jesus looking at me, eyebrow raised. Oh. And just like that, the anger just went. And I apologised, I repented. Don't know that I repented and apologised to Neil at the time, but I did, sorry. I did with the Lord straight away, and it was like the breath I took to rage just went. And I just turned around and cooked the dinner. Because I wasn't adding fuel to the fire went out. One look at Jesus. Yeah. That's all it took. And sometimes I say he doesn't barge in, but he makes sure that we see him sometimes. But it's being aware of his presence, because things do change. Yeah. And being focused on him. That's how we get through. I remember being, again, in the kitchen. I was moaning away at God, saying it's not fair. I can't see any light at the end of the tunnel that I was in. Family issues and everything. And I was having a good old moan. And then Jesus said, but you've got light in the tunnel. And that was a bit of a karate chop against the back of my knees, because it sort of took me off balance. I thought, wow, actually, of course, yes. Why didn't I remember that? I've been a Christian for years. What? Wasn't focusing on Jesus. He gives us the light. He walks us through. Doesn't matter that we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. He's the one who takes us through. Always, always and forever, always. He's with us. He says he would never leave us. He's with us always. Pay attention to his presence. Be aware of his presence. Know that the Holy Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead is the same Holy Spirit that is living in you. Focus on him. I'm always grateful to the disciple Peter. When he got out of the boat impetuously, he just said to the Lord, as he saw the Lord walking to him, can I come? Let me walk. Let me come too. And Jesus said, come on then, you come. So Peter got out of the boat. He started walking on the water, looking at Jesus all the time. Took his eyes off Jesus, looked at his circumstances, thought, no, this is impossible, and he sank. How many times have you done that? How many times have I done that? We're walking on the water. Circumstances are underneath us. We're walking on them. We're not living underneath them. Circumstances don't have to squash us. We can walk on them and above our circumstances, only if we keep our focus on Jesus being aware of his presence. And when he sank, Jesus helped him up. He didn't stand there saying, your fault, get on with it. No. Pulled him up, got him onto firm ground again, on the water, the firm ground. I had a lovely, a moment with, a God moment, as I was coming out of Kew Gardens, one of the last few visits that I went. I was coming out, heading towards the car park. Lost sight of Neil, couldn't see any cars. And what, for all intents and purposes, what I was looking at was water. And I just said to, I started laughing. I don't know who else was there, couldn't see anyone else. And I started laughing out loud, and I just said to God, I'm walking on water, because that's what it looked like to me. And I just said, I'm walking on water. And I was stomping. I was doing this. I was a kid again. What do you do when you walk in water? You splash. So that's what I was doing on the tarmac, for goodness sake. But I was kicking, I was stomping, and I was laughing with God. And it was quite a joyful time, actually, for those few minutes before things started appearing again. And it was like God was showing me that that's what it's like when you walk on water. It's firm underneath. When we walk on top of our circumstances, when we're not squashed by them, because Jesus wants us to live above our circumstances, no matter what your circumstances are, he wants you to live above them. They're not going anywhere, maybe, at the moment. They're still there, but he still wants you to live above them. But even when we live above them, there's still joy in that journey. And that's what Jesus was showing me. There's still joy. And the ground, because I used to think when Peter walked on the water, because when you look at water, it's fluid, isn't it? It moves. And I thought he must have been going like this when he was walking, you know, sort of being above it, but he must have been moving a bit. But I really had the sense that God was saying to me, no, what he was walking on was like what you're walking on. It was firm. And no matter what, you know, there's no movement there. And that's what it is when we focus on Jesus, no matter what our circumstances are, we're all different. We've all got different stories. Our circumstances, we can walk on them. And it's firm. When we focus on Jesus, that's what keeps us afloat. That's what keeps us going. Being aware of his presence. That's where our strength comes from. I'm going to shake Peter's hand when I see him in heaven and say thank you, because your example has really spoken to me and so many others through life on this earth. So many people have really taken a great deal of encouragement from that, and I shall shake his hand. I think there might be a few apologies I'll have to make to other people. The woman at the well, I need to apologise to her. I like to tell a joke about her. Who's the fattest woman in the Bible? It's the woman at the well. Why is that then? She's a woman of some area. Sorry. I have to apologise to her. But I think that's funny. So there we go. So yeah, some people to shake their hand and some people to say sorry. Yeah. So focus. Just focus on the Lord. I say my message today is quite simple. It's just being aware of his presence. Being aware. Be mindful of his presence. And that the other two verses, Neil, would you probably, you've got them, haven't you? Wherever you may be, you're there somewhere. I know you are. Where are you? Could you just read those out? Yep. The other two verses from today.
Okay. Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And then Joshua 1 verse 9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you.
Thank you. He never leaves us alone. He never leaves us to walk alone. He's there with us. No matter what your circumstances are, as I say, we've all got different stories to tell. We can live above them. When we become a Christian, we don't suddenly get a meal ticket through life that everything is going to be wonderful. It isn't. But we have Jesus with us. He has promised never to leave us. He's promised to take us on adventures. And he is always there to launch us into those adventures. And he comes with us. No matter if it looks impossible, he does it. And we do it because if we've got our focus on him, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. As long as we realise it's him who is doing it and not trusting on our own strength because we haven't got any. Not to do the things that we can be doing for him. So it's not a meal ticket through life. But in my view, it is a bed of roses. Not the newfangled things that have been played around with these days that have got no thorns, no smell, and so sort of perfect. No, not a rose like that. I'm talking about the old-fashioned roses. We've got one in our garden, and we got given a bunch a few days ago by a friend. They're the roses that have got the big heads. And statement roses, really. And the thorns on the stem are ridiculous. You just can't, there's nowhere you can sort of pinch it to hold a rose because it's covered in thorns, whether they're small thorns or the long ones, it's just covered. And that's what life is. We have suffering. The Apostle Paul says, suffering, we have suffering, and that goes on to produce the patience and the endurance. That goes on to produce our character. And that goes on to produce the hope in Jesus that will never, ever fail us. It starts with suffering. It starts with the difficulties. But it ends in a hope that never fails us. One of my favourite verses about hope, and I'll say it to anyone who stays still long enough so I can say it to, is a paraphrase of Hebrews 11, verse 1. And that's the paraphrase is, hope is hearing the melody of the future, and faith is dancing to it now. So whatever God is saying to you, you're hearing that melody, you dance to it now as if it's here. You dance to it. That's what I'm doing with my sight. I know what God said. I know it's impossible. I know on paper, I should say, it's impossible. But when God says it, that settles it. That's it. So I'm believing for my healing this side of eternity. And I'm waiting. Again, a bit of patience sometimes. I have stamped my foot in the street. I was in Beer. Not in Beer, you understand? But I was in the place called Beer in Devon. And I know from memory that is an absolutely beautiful street. But I remember stamping my foot, just quietly on my own, but it was still a stamp, saying, God, I'm missing out. And it's like, get on with it, come on. And then behaving after that. But yeah, I get frustrated. I know I can hear the melody, and that melody is getting louder for me. So I'm waiting, and I'm hoping. But that hope does not fail. Jesus does not fail. But I'm dancing to that melody now. Because I forget that I can't see. A few weeks ago, I made some sandwiches. And I was in the kitchen and I cried with so much frustration. I thought, why can't I do this, for goodness sake? Everything, I had it all, I felt it, it was all going lovely. And then I'm trying to put it all together in a sandwich and cutting it. Forget it. But I thought, why can't I do this? Because I just forget that I can't see. I have some sight. It's between 0 and 5%, that's what I'm told. And it was to do with the light. If it gets too glary, then I have nothing. That's where Neil's very good, because his hand is there, and he's guiding me. And sometimes we have a little argument, because I'm seeing things that aren't there now, which is quite interesting. I'm seeing walls, and I'm thinking, no, I don't want to scuff myself on the wall. And he says, what are you doing? I said, I'm trying to avoid the wall. There is no wall. Yes, there is. No, there isn't. Yes, there is. So, and then I'd take a swipe at it with my stick, and it's like, oh, no, there isn't. So things are a bit different now. It's but just when you think it's can't get any worse, it does. I fell over after Christmas in home, and the sight's changed as well. So it's... Yeah, it's interesting, but I know God's got me. I'm hearing that melody and it's getting louder and I'm dancing to that tune now. And I forget I can't see, which is interesting. And how God talks to me is in picture form, which I find quite ironic. But because I can't see. Well, I can, but I can't, if you know what I mean. So God speaks to us in our own language, doesn't he? Whether it's through the written word, which we love, where some of us are more word people, some of us are more picture people. It all depends on how he's made us, as to how he talks to us. So look to him, turn to him, be aware of him, pay attention, because don't just think, oh, I talked to him, because I've done this. I prayed at the beginning of the day, I prayed at the end of the day. And at the end of the day, sometimes I think, well, where was God in my day? I forgot about him. I just got on. And that made me screw up inside. I think that's so wrong. We should be paying attention to him. He lives in us. The same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me and lives in you. Pay attention to him. Acknowledge that. Love him. You won't forget him if you love him. That's the first command, isn't it? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, all your mind, everything you've got. I can't believe that when Moses came down from the mountain, well, I know that he sort of met with a very sinful people because they all thought he wasn't coming back and they decided to create their own God through melting some gold and making a golden calf. So that lot of Ten Commandments got broken because out of anger, Moses sort of threw them down. But then he went back and he got them again. But when he sort of shared them with the people, do you think because of the time that he spent with God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, all of them, Holy Spirit, do you think that he came down from that mountain after spending the time with the Lord and just said, oh, by the way, lads, gather round, I've got something to say to you? Don't think so. I think his relationship with God, because he was spending time with him, he was aware of him. He asked God for his glory to pass before him, didn't he? I think he would have stood up on a rock to his full height and said, love him! Love him with all your heart. Love him with all your soul. Love him with all your might. Love him with everything you've got. And that's what Jesus is saying to you today. Love him. Love him with everything you've got. All your heart, all your soul, all your might. Everything. Love him. Keep him close. Be aware of him. He is in you. Carry his presence and cherish his presence. Nathan's going to come up now and just sing a song, but he's going to put the words up and sing along. Once you've got the grips of it, sing along as a prayer. This song was written in a time of emotional and physical pain, about 15 years ago now. It started off as a prayer. Just one line prayer. And then God said, write it down. And then the rest came. But it was a time of pain. But it saw us through. The words that he's about to sing saw us through, and they were God-given words. So whatever you are walking through, know that your God is walking with you. If you are walking through the valley of the shadow, don't camp there. You're not supposed to camp there. You're supposed to walk through with him. Keep walking. He's the light in your tunnel. He will see you through. And in these days, I think Yash alluded to it earlier, there's work to be done in this city. There's work to be done in this land. And you are part of that work. There are places for you to be going, people for you to be seeing. You can't do it on your own. Don't you dare try and do it on your own. God will call you into whatever it is he's got for you, your pathway. He will walk with you. You take your strength from him. You walk from him. Be aware of him. Pay attention to him and love him. Love him. I can't forget Neil and Nathan during the day. I love them. Don't forget God. Love him with everything you've got. Love them. Love him. Love him. So I'm just going to pass over to Nathan now. So, please use this song as a response to the Lord in prayer. Thank you.
Treasured offering, I keep my eyes locked into your eyes, keep my face turned to you, keep my love as a treasured offering. Bring refreshment to my soul. Anchor mount pulls a blessing to rise up before me. When I put my trust in you, then I find my strength in you. Keep my eyes locked into your eyes. Keep my face turned to you. Keep my love as a treasured offering. Keep my eyes locked into your eyes. Keep my face turned to you. Keep my love as a treasured offering. I would drink of your love and feed on your faithfulness. I would satisfy myself with your abundant grace, Jesus. And I'll carry your presence, God, and I'll cherish your presence, oh Lord. And when I my trust in you. Then I find my strength in you. And I'll carry your presence, oh God. And I'll cherish your presence, oh Lord.